national factor, a great bottleneck in connection with the defense of the United States. To create the necessary forces, we have to have experienced people. We have to have material with which to create those forces, not so much to arm them as to permit them to prepare themselves. Therefore, anything we sent to the Philippines that could have had any possible effect on the situation out there would practically deny us of the ability to create an army, to create a defense out there that was in any degree adequate. Now, as I've said, quantity production was making its first appearance, really, in about August 1941. And as I've said, we turned from the meeting of the demands in Hawaii and not fulfilling the Martin Bellinger request for 180 B-17s, of which we only possessed all over the world 148 at that particular time. We turned to our endeavor to set up sufficient force in the Philippine Islands to guard the islands, to be a threat to any Japanese movement through the China Sea, and to possibly avert a war in the Pacific. We had equipped so far as we thought it possible to equip, and instructed so far as we thought it was necessary to instruct, the garrison in the Hawaiian Islands. We were now engaged in trying to do for General MacArthur what he so urgently required. I think that is a reasonable explanation of why, from August on, we were working in the Far East rather than a continuation of discussions and of one kind or another and of material items to the Hawaiian garrison. Have I made that fairly plain, sir? We had succeeded in getting 35 flying fortresses to the Philippines, incidentally sending them via Wake Island and then Port Moresby or Rabaul or Port Darwin or Balapapkin in Borneo, north to the Philippines. Those had been made available by reason of additional funds that were appropriated by Congress to expedite production, which always costs a great deal more money. The result of that was that the following deliveries, which we had assumed would immediately come after those 35, from the plants, were delayed several weeks, I think about 3 weeks. There was a gap, in other words, in the delivery of B-17s. Not only that, but after we got the crews into the delivered ships, we then found that the adverse winds at an unexpected period between Hawaii and California prevented the flight. I might add that the flight of the 35 was the first time a B-17, in other words, a land-based plane, had attempted the crossing from 24 to 2,700 miles. It became a common thing later on with wider cruising radius. So these ships were held on the West Coast, B-17s. General Arnold can give you direct testimony regarding this from my point of view and memory. I sent him out personally to the West Coast to see if they were doing everything possible. First, to get these planes completed for the flight with the extra tanks and things that are required, and next, to take off for the flight. Naturally, the young men, the squadron leaders, couldn't be told all the various factors in the case, except that we wanted them to leave as quickly as possible. So General Arnold made the trip personally. My recollection is he called me up on the phone shortly after he'd arrived out there, and he said, these damn fellas don't realize how serious this thing is. And I told him, well, I said, you're there and they're your people. Which I'm quite certain he's right. I don't recall it, but he's undoubtedly right. That he asked me at the time of our second conversation that morning if that they had a rapid means of communication and that I'd wish to use it. And I told him no. He couldn't, that must be a fact. I don't recall it. It must be a fact. That, I think, covers the main details.
Now, do you remember your movements on the evening of December 6th where you were?
I can only account for that by sort of circumstantial evidence, Mr. Mitchell. The only definite thing I have is that I had no dinner engagement. I found our engagement book, or Mrs. Marshall's engagement book, and between the 1st of November and the 7th of December, I had one dinner engagement. That was the 2nd of December. Also, they checked up on the post-movie theater, which was about our only recourse for relaxation, and I have never seen the picture, so I was not there. We did not go calling. We were leading a rather monastic life. And there was also in the record the affairs of the day for her, which involved a, I think, an old clothes sale or something of that sort all day long to raise money for one of these ministries they had downtown. So the high probability is she was tired and we were home.
But you weren't sure you weren't at the White House?
No, sir, not at all. To Colonel Phillips, as I have explained here, after the attack was going on, because we could hear the explosions at the time.
Well, you didn't telephone anywhere.
I didn't telephone anywhere. First.
What did you say to him?
As nearly as I can recall, I asked him if he had seen the message. He said that he had, and I proposed that we send a message apropos of this to the various commanders concerned. And he replied, as I've outlined, that he feared that that would tend to confuse them. We'd given them an alert, and now we were putting something else into the picture. I then went ahead and wrote the message. And I don't think I said to him, in concluding that first conversation, whether or not I was going to do it. But I did write it out immediately in longhand.
And
my recollection was that he called me, but the records of the White House telephone exchange show I called him. I had thought that he called me to say he wanted this shown to the naval opposite. It would seem from the records at the White House that I called him and maybe read the message. In any event, he did ask me, I'm specific about that, he did ask me to put into the message that it be shown to my naval opposite, to the naval opposite. I don't recollect, sir. I've got a faint recollection of coming back once and telling me 8 minutes to get it through. But I think you have positive testimony on that that's coming. There was no mention of the 1 p.m. message until I came across it at the end of the pile. I'm quite clear about that, because I was very much taken back at the time I'd expended on the preceding lengthy message, trying to understand its significance, and arriving at this, to me, very critical one of 1 p.m. Well, I don't know about that. I'm just talking about my own reaction. I don't recall that. I don't recall that at all. The whole thing was it a significant message? And what do we tell these commanders? And I went right ahead and wrote it out myself.
Did you talk to the President on the morning of the 7th before the attack?
Not to my recollection. I think appointment. I think the records show, and that's my only source of